All right, you ready? What do you think, you ready? Isn't it fun to stop and think, man, what an amazing blessing a body like this is? A place to come and laugh till your side hurts and then come back in the morning and just bask to sit at the throne of God and now to just prepare to open his word and wonder, what's he gonna say? Earlier this year, I guess it was 2011, really, I went to my middle daughter's bedroom to pray with her because it was the night before her first day of junior high. Now, that makes me sound like a better dad than I am. I'm not completely sure I've gone to pray with her since. But that night, I knew it was a really important night. I knew she was a little worried, and there's all the anxieties. And so I said, you want to do this? And she's like, yeah. And I said, okay, how you want to do it? And she flips all the covers off her bed. She throws her body into the air, lands on the bed, pulls the sheet over her head, and lays there. And I said, you ready? And the sheet nodded, yeah. And I thought, this is just so funny. That works, right? You can pray with a sheet over your head. But isn't it funny that something like prayer, something so simple, can cause such anxiety in us that we need to actually hide under a sheet to do it. Do you remember the first time that you had to pray in front of a group of people? And your heart starts beating and you're breathing fast and your hands are shaking and you're so worried about, you know this was true, you're so worried about doing it right. Or you get worried about saying the right words like it's a spell you're casting. If you don't get the words right, God won't. Or you get anxious. You remember the first time you're in a room and somebody else is praying out loud and nobody's really told you what to do when that happens? Some of you still do this. Somebody's praying out loud and you're thinking, okay, the other Christians are nodding their heads. I guess I should nod my head. Yeah. Amen. And you're thinking in your mind the whole time, what do I do? Do I say those words while he's saying them? Should I be repeating it in my head? Do I just listen for key points? Or I wonder what's going to be on TV tonight. I was, amen. And you come back, because you don't know. And there's all this anxiety, and it gets really confusing. And you start talking to people, and you find people who write their prayers, or you'll find people who pray on their face, or on their knees, or on their back, or on their feet. You'll find people who pray with really big words, and then you'll meet people who don't pray with words. And it creates stress, and you don't know is it okay to do it in public? What about meals? What's that all about? And you're just supposed to do it in a closet? I don't know where that came from. And maybe that's in the Bible. And suddenly this thing becomes a chore. And it's intimidating. And we don't know what to do. And so there's this moment in your Bible when the disciples, who are just like us, see Jesus praying. And they seize on the moment because they think, he's doing it. Let's ask him to show us how to do that. And in Luke chapter 11, that's exactly what happens. They see Jesus praying and they yell out, teach us to pray. And in the Greek, there's actually a sense of urgency. It's almost a teach us to pray now, because they realize Jesus is praying. Here's our chance. We can figure this out. You know that's in your Bible, by the way? In Luke 11, there's a moment where Jesus answers the question, how do we pray? What do we do? And he tells us. So flip over there. Luke's in the New Testament. It's in the back half. It's one of the thick books early on. Jesus answers this, but he doesn't. And this is like Jesus, right? He doesn't stop with actually answering the question. He goes a little further and he exposes something behind the question. Because there's this danger to prayer, and maybe you've run into it. We slip into this trap where we try to pray correctly. And I hinted at it a minute ago, but it's really insidious. You suddenly find yourself trying to get the right prayer, and if you back up and look at it, you actually are stumbling into sorcery, not prayer. I mean, the moment you think, if I get the words right, God will act on my behalf, is the moment that you crossed over and thought, if I do things right, I can cause magic from heaven to happen. And that's not what's going on when you're praying. And so Jesus answers their question, but he goes a little bit further. As a matter of fact, in Luke 11, he'll break it into three pieces. First, he'll deal with, what do you pray? And then he will say, when do you pray? And finally, and this was the most important part, because he wasn't just concerned with them understanding prayer. He needed to make sure the big piece was in place. To whom do you pray? Because if you get that one right, the other stuff takes care of itself. And he makes sure you know before he's done. Big issue here, guys, is that you know who you're talking to. So what do you pray? When do you pray? And to whom? It starts in Luke 11, verse 1. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. Just as John taught his disciples. I love that, because we often go to God and we have a question and we need a reason. Oh, God, we've got a really good reason for it. John's guys taught him. He taught people to pray, so maybe you should teach us to pray. We think we got to justify it when you ask, and Jesus does there what he does so many times when you think you have to justify it. He ignores it. Just skips it. If you study this a little bit, you'll learn that in this moment when he teaches them to pray, he actually does it differently than he does over in the book of Matthew when he's out in front of a big crowd. And hopefully that's enough to make you realize the words he gives here, it's not a formula. This isn't the only way to pray. This isn't a list of always say this set of stuff. He's not doing that. He actually changed it himself. He taught it more than one way at different times. He's going to focus on something bigger. He's going to focus on a conversation. He's going to give us some boundaries and kind of put it in context. So read this. He said to them, this is just him and his disciples, right? Us, his followers. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, pater, in Greek. It's from the Aramaic Hebrew word, Abba, dad. And it's not the father, my father, or a father. Make sure you notice that. In Greek, it's in the vocative. It's a direct address. It's used like a name. Instead of saying the father, you're just calling him that. That's the name you'll call him. The first thing Jesus teaches you, disciple, about prayer is that as far as you're concerned, the name of God is Father. That's a big deal. The first thing is you need to understand that you call him that like it's his name. Dad, Pop, Father. Do you do that? Do you assume that? Because many of you are carrying scars from your own dads and your own fathers. There's whole books written around the father wound that so many of us carry. You spend your whole life trying to get the approval, the nod, the satisfaction of this man in your life, and you struggle and fail, and it becomes this big banner over your whole existence, just trying to make your dad happy. When my dad died back in 2009, I went to visit him in the hospital that last week, and I've told you part of this story. He had asked that when I got there, the one thing he wanted me to do was crawl in bed with him. And so I got into this hospital bed, and my 80-some pound father curled up in my arms, and I held him there, and he leaned over, and he looked in my eyes, and he said, I'm so proud of you. When I think back, the last 7 years we talked before he passed away, every conversation we had, he said that for 7 years. So when my dad died, I knew. I didn't wonder anymore. I had his approval. I'd had it for a really long time. Guess what? If you trust Jesus, then you have your father's approval. You don't have to wonder. You're accepted. He approves of you. He calls you child. You can call him dad. It's the devil that makes you doubt that. It's not him. He pushes it pretty hard. Call him like it's his name, Father. And then he says, keeps going in verse 2, Father, hallowed be your name. Hallowed's a weird word, right? We don't use that very often in conversation. I had a hallowed day. It's from the same word in Greek where we get holy, hagios, same word, but it's written as a command to make something holy, but it's tricky, and that's why they translate it weird, because you're commanding something to happen, but it's passive. You're commanding something to happen that you can't make happen. And so we get a weird word like hallowed, and it's really confusing. The idea is you're saying to God, God, your name must be holy, but I can't do it. I can't make it holy. God, you got to do it. You got to make it holy. And it's tricky because you think about what's that mean? Does that mean we shouldn't say, oh my God, anymore? We need to quit using that? And hey, by the way, this is a personal pet peeve. I'm going to take a time out from the sermon. I wish this was in Scripture and it's not. We need some more adjectives. If you watch TV lately, everything's, oh my God. It's like amazing, extraordinary, astounding. There's a lot of really good words beside having to throw that one around, but that's not what it means. That's not what he means here, unfortunately. It's a bigger deal than that. When Jesus says that his name has to be holy, you pray that to him. He's talking about the whole person of God, his whole reputation, his character. It's a different way of saying it would be, Father, establish your reputation. Establish your holiness. Or even shorter, Father, be holy. Because he has to make it happen. You can't. Even shorter, Father, be God. The theologian Scott McKnight in Relevant Magazine back in August says, here's the problem with that. Here's what's being addressed in that moment. You want to be God. And that's part of why Jesus maybe stuck it in the prayer. You think about this in your sin struggles. So many of the things you wrestle with that tempt you and you fall into start with sentences like, I want my way, I'll have my say, I'll choose what to drink, I'll choose what to have sex with and when, I will choose these things, I want to be respected, loved, adored, worshiped. You in your flesh want to be God, and you're not. And the first part of Jesus' prayer is setting the context correct. Father, you be God. I won't be. He keeps going in verse 2. Your kingdom come. It's another command, but this time the command is for God. You're actually praying to God, God, make this happen. You're telling God what to do, and what you're telling him to do is to be king. To rule. Now, this one's tricky because it refers to a future kingdom that God will establish that began when Christ returned and will be culminated in the return of Christ yet again when he sets all things right. And so there's this future kingdom, but there's also this immediate sense that you're calling God to rule now. Start with me. And so the prayer means both things. Lord, establish your kingdom on earth. Come back. And that part's easy for us to deal with, right? It's easy to pray. Come back. It's a little trickier, and we miss it sometimes. Father, establish your kingdom, but start with me. Be my king. King me. A simpler way to say it is, Father, rule. Rule and start with me. Father, you be God, and I won't be. Father, rule me. That's not a formula. Right? It's just an attitude. It's just to get this right. You understand who God is. This first thing you do when you pray to him is you kind of set that. He loves you. He's God. You're not. Father, lead me. Rule me. And that fits with what we'll see later, right? It's kind of tricky when you read in Luke and in the Gospels, Jesus isn't dead yet. The Holy Spirit hasn't been poured out yet. It's going to come later, but this fits. There's places where Jesus starts to teach as though some of these things have already happened. And here, in the later letters, we'll start to pray things like, fill me with your spirit. It's the same idea. Be in control of me. It's a daily thing. Whose life is it? Is it mine and I'm letting God borrow it, or is it his and he's loaned it to me? It's a big question. Verse 3. Rule me, and then here in verse 3, meet my most basic needs. Give us each day our daily bread. Meet my most fundamental needs. Bread in Scripture is rarely ever just bread. I mean, early Christians would have heard this passage. They would have thought back to the story of Moses. Moses taking the Israelites out of Egypt way back in the book of Exodus. And for 40 years wandering around the desert, and every morning when they got up, there on the ground was this stuff they called manna. In other places in your Bible, they'll call it the bread of heaven. It was on the ground, they could pick it up and they could eat it. And so for 40 years and God giving them bread, what God was actually doing was giving them life. They were utterly dependent. He fed them with his hands for 40 years. And anytime the Scripture talks about bread, it's not just talking about bread. It's talking about life itself, about being utterly dependent on God for your most basic of needs. And this prayer is a reminder of dependence. And the struggle for us is that even though we can't sustain our own lives, we try to. We try to in all kinds of creative ways. When I find out that I'm going to have to trust God for my very food, the first thing I start doing is thinking of all the ways around that. What could I do if I really had to get food in my mouth? I've got a friend who came to Christ back in April. And before that, and even a little bit after that, she used to pay her bills by dancing. Exotically. And now she's learning how to trust God to provide for her daily needs, to pay her bills, without her taking it into her own hands. Because that's what we're all tempted to do. This is part of your prayer. It's not easy. That's why you're asking the Father, your Father. In verse 4, now, this part gets really confusing. It doesn't have to be. You say, forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. Now, you've heard it preached many times from this stage. Once you're in Christ, you're already forgiven. You don't have to go seek that out anymore. And that's very true. It's not necessarily true yet in Luke 11. Jesus hasn't died. And so always remember that when you're reading the Gospels. Jesus is teaching, but some of the things we know now don't happen until a little bit later in the next couple of years in Scripture. But even without that, he's still not teaching that you've got to go and daily seek out forgiveness. That's not the idea here. And you can think about it in three different ways. There's a context here first. What was your relationship to God at the beginning of the prayer? Anybody? You have a relationship with him. There's a name you call him. What was it? Father. That didn't change here, right? You think about this. My kids have a father. It's me. Just for the record. Just need to know that. Right, honey? Okay. Get nod when I ask that. When they come to apologize for something they've done in my life, we don't renegotiate the relationship. We don't stop and go, wait a minute, speak more slowly because I got to decide if I'm still going to be your dad. We don't do that. There's no, you did what to my iPhone? You disown. That doesn't happen. It's not happening here. It's just about the quality of relationship. You just told him he's holy, right? You asked him to rule you, right? So part of the prayer is you also fess up, clear the air, confess of what he already knows you're dealing with. So there's a context, but there's also a lesson here. This isn't about salvation. There's a trick you stumble into in the Bible all the time. Anytime the word forgiveness is used, you think, oh no, I'm going to hell. That's not what it means. You're secure. He's your Father. Salvation, those pieces are going to come later. Jesus is going to explain it as that year goes on. This is more about just the relationship. Okay, in my house, it happens like this. Somebody comes to me and says, Dad, I'm sorry I hit my sister. And I say, did you tell your sister? And they go, no. And I say, why don't you go tell your sister and then come and talk to me? It's not because I haven't forgiven them or that I even need to. I'm teaching them. I'm teaching them to forgive, like I do in their lives. And that was the prayer, right? Father, make me like you. Teach me. I want to forgive the way you forgive. So there's a context, a lesson, and then there's a theology. And this is a little tricky to see in your translation. Let me read it again. Here's the literal. Here's what happens in the Greek. Forgive our sins, uses the word sins, for we also forgive all, it doesn't use the word sin here. It says, for we also forgive all in debt to us. It's not the same word. So that's handy when you think about it theologically. What I'm asking God to forgive me for is not the same thing that he's calling me to forgive other people for. But it ties these two ideas together. Sin and debt are related. They're similar ideas. Sin has a price, like debt. It always has a price. Who paid the price? The debt that you owe God. Now be careful. This is a trick question. Because in Luke 11, nobody. Yet, very soon, Jesus will. And one of the dangers of grace is that we forget things like this. You ever think about grace as a dangerous idea? One of the dangers of grace is that sometimes we forget and think that sin doesn't hurt anyone. That's not true. It's not true. The price is going to be really, really high. They don't understand this fully yet when Jesus is teaching the disciples, but very soon they will. Jesus is teaching them to pray, and he's saying, you ask God to forgive when others owe you. Just like your Father is going to forgive all that you're going to owe me. Ask the Father to let you forgive in the same way that he's about to forgive you for what you owe me. Later in the New Testament, we pray it differently. We'll say, Lord, let your grace work through me and extend to others. But they're learning it right here. Now, speaking of sin, verse 4 keeps going. And lead us not into temptation. Now, that's not what we usually pray, right? We tend to say, Lord, when I'm tempted, make me strong. Lord, when I go tomorrow to meet with that woman that I haven't told my wife I'm meeting with, make me strong because I'm stupid. And if I'd paid attention to Jesus, I wouldn't be going. We tend to go into those scenarios. Lord, I'm going to be with friends tonight that are really going to push me to drink more than I should. Make me strong because I'm going anyway. Jesus says, no, don't pray that. Literally, the prayer is don't allow us to be tempted because Jesus knows you. It's not about you being strong in the moment. It's about keeping you away from it because you're weak. You're weak, and you don't really understand temptation. You think that you're tempted by porn, sex, alcohol, eating, purging, shopping, whatever, but you're wrong. You're actually tempted to meet your needs on your own terms. You're tempted to take it into your own hands and be God. And that's funny, because that's where the prayer started, right? Father, you be God, and I won't be. He brings it full circle. When he tells them, here's what you should pray, you could almost summarize the whole prayer with those two ideas. Father, rule me. It's not a formula. You can add all the words you want to that. You can pray it in a closet, under a sheet, out in the street, whatever. But the basic idea is the same all the way through the New Testament. Father, lead. You can fill that out. You can spend hours. You can get on your knees. You can journal it in. But that's kind of the core. That's kind of always there in our prayers. What do you pray? Father, rule me. That's the first answer. The second answer starts at verse 5 when he starts to explain when do you pray. And to do that, Jesus tells a story. They may have thought he was done. That was pretty good, right? Here's this amazing prayer, and it's really not a formula. It's about this relationship I have with my Father, and I'm just asking it to come and be filled out in my life. That's really good. And then Jesus keeps going. He doesn't stop. And that was probably confusing, and it's going to get worse because it's going to be embarrassing. He tells a story about an embarrassed man. In Jewish culture, hospitality was a really big deal. It was very important that if a guest showed up at your house, you could provide for that guest. You should be ready for that. You should be prepared for it because you may be called on to be a host. And this story Jesus tells at verse 5 is a guy who wasn't ready and he was called upon and he was a lousy host and he didn't even have enough bread for his friend who had come to stay at his home. And so in entertaining his options, he decides he will get up and go to his neighbor's house, who is prepared and always is ready and has plenty of bread. But he does it at midnight. And just in case you think, oh, things were different back then, midnight was kind of cool. No, it's midnight. It's not okay. It was never okay at midnight. It's not okay today at midnight. The man is asleep. And when you read in the passage, you'll see that his whole family is sleeping in one room. And by pounding on the neighbor's door, he's waking up the whole family. And the neighbor yells, "Go away. The door is already latched for the night." And the guy keeps pounding. And Jesus says the neighbor will finally get up and give them the bread, not because he's his friend, but because this guy is obnoxious. And the audacity of pounding on the door at midnight. And you read the story and you think, okay, what do we learn about God? And it's like, hold on, this one's not about God. That's going to be in a minute. This one's about you. And guess who you are? You're the obnoxious, unprepared neighbor. And guess what? It's okay. When can you pray? At midnight. When you're unprepared. When you're humiliated. When we first built this building, some of you have stumbled into this. It's a little confusing to know which things work by themselves and which things don't. So if you go in one of the bathrooms, you're never really sure if it's going to flush itself or if you got to do something or how many of you've waved your hands under the sink and you're not sure. Some of you have done this in other places. You just stand there waving and somebody finally says, dude, it's the old school kind. And, oh, you got to turn the water on. Well, it's confusing. It's really kind of mind-boggling sometimes, but in the staff bathroom over where the offices are, we've got one of those light sensors that automatically turns the lights off if there's nobody in the room. You walk in, lights come on, a little bit later, lights go off. Well, when we first built the building, that was hooked up. And something you learned the hard way is if you have one of those days, which I did, when you're halfway through your work day and you realize you're not going to make it all day, you're going to have to go sit down in the public bathroom. And you found out pretty quickly that when they designed the motion sensor, once you shut the door to the public bathroom, it couldn't see you anymore. And if, by chance, which is what happened, you were in there too long, the lights went out. And it's in the offices. There's no emergency exit. There's no little glowing light. It's pitch black. And you're alone and embarrassed because you were unprepared. And so I had to decide what to do. And I thought, well, I got an iPhone. I'm not risking dropping that and anything. So I decided the only thing I could do other than just die, and in days, eventually they'll discover my body here. Because, you know, when you're humiliated, you're tempted to just despair and give up. I decided I'd just have to swallow my pride and call for help. So I started yelling, help! Help! That went on for a few minutes. And then sweet Karen Mooney. Some of you know Karen. Cracked open that door, waved her hand in front of that thing. I had light. In those humiliated moments, when you're caught with your pants down, you're so tempted just to give up. And Jesus says, when can you pray? Right then. At the height of your embarrassment. Even if it was your fault, you were unprepared, you were foolish, you're caught off guard. Right then. That's not when you run from God. That's not when you despair. That's when you pound on his door obnoxiously. That's okay. That's amazing, right? They ask him to teach us to pray, and one of the biggest things he deals with is, wait, you need to understand who you are. You're the obnoxious idiot in the story. Make sure you know that. But it's okay. And you can pound on the door any time, especially when you're humiliated, especially in that moment, at midnight, whenever. Ask, seek, knock. The door will be opened. He's your Father. Remember? Because just in case you forgot that he's your Father, Jesus tells one more story. He says, what do you pray? And then he says, when do you pray? And finally, to whom do you pray? This is one of my favorite passages in the Bible. I call it the God is not a jerk passage. Because sometimes we treat God like he's a jerk. Brennan Manning says we take the worst things about ourselves and our own fathers and the scars we carry, and we project that onto God, and we assume that's how he's going to treat us. Any day now, he's going to take away something precious. Or there's no way he could let me keep this. It's too good. My life is coming together. Any day now, he's going to wreck it. He's just going to do something mean to me. He's going to punish me. He's going to drop me. We project all of our worst fears onto God, our Father. And Jesus is teaching us, you can pound on God's door at midnight, your Father, because he's not a jerk. It's here in verse 11. Which of you, fathers, if your son asks for a fish, we'll give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, we'll give him a scorpion? If you then, though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? He loves you. He's not evil like you. And even you wouldn't give your kids a scorpion. My friend Aaron's wife says that God will always act in the most loving way toward you. What do you pray? Father, rule me. When do you pray? Any time, especially when you're embarrassed. And to whom do you pray? You pray to the God, your Father, and he loves you. He's not a jerk. A few weeks ago, a friend sent me a text message, and it said, doesn't it say, if you seek God, that you will find him? Well, that's in Luke 11. It's that story about the obnoxious guy. We kind of skipped it. Ask and it'll be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be opened. A few texts later, she sends to me, this is a beautiful text. I've got it saved. She said, gosh, I hope I find out the truth. Can you meet soon? I think that's curious. Because when you read the passage, Jesus doesn't make a whole lot of promises. He talks a lot about bread, right? We're to ask for bread in the prayer. Give us our daily bread, and the implication is he'll provide our most basic needs. And then this obnoxious guy, he needs bread, and he's going to get it because he can pound on the door at midnight. But the children, they needed, well, he changes it. They didn't need bread. They asked for fish and eggs, and then God doesn't give it. Instead, it's kind of cryptic when you read it. They, which is really us, need food, but instead God gives, read this in verse 13. If you then, though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Huh. Well, in the Bible, bread is rarely ever just bread. It's the way. It's the truth that my friend was looking for. It's life. It's Jesus. Now, in Luke 11, they didn't fully understand that yet. But by Luke chapter 22, when Jesus is sitting down with the same men, he says to them, "Eat this bread. It's my body. It's me. I'm the bread of life." And now that he's resurrected, we get that through his Holy Spirit. We get the life of Christ. We get bread through the Holy Spirit who now lives in us. A promise he made back here in Luke 11, 13, a promise they didn't quite understand yet because they didn't quite get that God was about to pour his Spirit onto the earth and into the lives of all of those who claim Jesus. But we do. And that changes things. It changes the way you read this prayer. The means by which God will bring about his rule in your life is here at the end of the passage, through the Spirit. I was praying with my daughter that night before junior high. And once she got under the sheet and I said, "It's your turn, you ready?" And she nodded. Here's what she prayed. She said, "Jesus, help me not be lost. And we all feel lost sometimes, unsure how to relate to God. You're caught in that humiliating moment, and you're not sure if it's okay to talk to him, or you're ashamed, and the devil whispers in your ear, 'Not now. He's ashamed of you.'" And it's a lie. It's a lie. If you have the Spirit, you're not lost. Ever. He's got you. He's your Father. Pray these words often. They're not magic. But pay attention to the bigger picture. Make sure you know who you're praying to. And the big picture of the prayer is, "Father, take me. Rule me. Do what you want in me." And the Spirit who now lives in you will make it happen. He will rule you. But if you don't have the Spirit, you are lost. So ask. If what on earth is keeping you from asking for the bread of life, Jesus, ask, and the door will be opened. The next day, my friend who had been texting me, a friend who had been knocking, the door was opened, and she got bread. Just like her, if you ask, he'll enter. He'll give you the Holy Spirit, and then the Holy Spirit will lead you too. So we close up today. We're going to put these words on the screen. I'm going to challenge us to pray through these. If you have the Spirit, then take comfort in knowing that the Spirit is the means by which this happens in the life of the believer. We are learning to live in a pattern that Jesus calls us to. As you surrender to that, which is exactly what this prayer is about. It's a prayer of surrender. Father, you be God. Rule me. And if you don't have the Spirit, as we go through these words, take this moment to knock, ask, seek. Because he tells you he'll give himself to you. Let's pray. Father, hallowed be your name. Pray with me. Your kingdom come, give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation. In the name of Jesus, amen. God bless you all as you head out today. We'll see you next week as we start to dig into the book of Galatians. Have a blessed Sunday with your Father.